Good morning, Sister Tara.
Good morning, Sister Pauline. What a lovely pocket watch.
Thank you. This was made by Brother Johann Eberhardt, and I'm here to make sure it's keeping time. Since it's such a sunny day today, I thought I'd use the sundial. Look at that shadow. Isn't it beautiful?
I do like it. And I love how my shadow changes size and direction throughout the day.
You know what's interesting is they used to be able to tell time only with the lights in the sky.
Like the sun and the moon and the stars?
Yes, very good. Did you know that the sun is a star? Yes, it is. They would look at the patterns of the sky, like the phases of the moon, and they'd be able to tell what month it was. That science that they studied, the stars, the sun, the moon, and the space, that's called astronomy. People thought that the sun was going around the Earth when in fact it was our planet, the Earth, that was moving around the sun. So it makes the sun create different shadows throughout the day because we're moving. We are so blessed that Brother Christian Reuter put this brass sundial in the middle of the square because I can set my watch by it, which means I'm going to be telling time with this and making sure my watch is correct. Which reminds me of someone I know that was always late. When he went to the doctor recommended that he go to sleep in the herb garden. I know it sounds odd, but now he always wakes up on time. You know, a sundial's not that easy to set up. I did read in the Helper's conference records about the time Brother Reuter planned the setup in 1772. He had to set the gnomon so that it faced true north. By setting it up at noon, there wouldn't be any shadow on the face of the dial. But the sundial gradually falls out of synchronization with clock time because the Earth's orbit around the sun is elliptical, which means that the sun's rays vary with the season.
It's so good to know this because I really only understand watches. I'm glad I have them. I really don't understand the sundial that much.
Well, great. I will explain it to you and show you how to set your watch by it. So this is a sundial, and this is called the gnomon. It is like a pole that sticks up in the middle of the sundial. Now, when the sun goes across it, the gnomon blocks part of it with its shadow. And wherever the shadow lands, that is the number of the time that it is right now. So you can tell that these numbers here don't look like ours. Those are Roman numerals. You would need to know how to read Roman numerals in order to use this to set your watch.
So according to this, it looks like it's about 11 o'clock?
Yes, very good. That is an 11 in Roman numerals. Good job.
I have noticed that when the sun is at about noon, my shadow seems much shorter. It's almost like I'm acting like a sundial.
Yes, you know what? Did you know there's a dog that always knows how to tell time?
Would that be a watchdog?
It is a watchdog. Oh, it's perfectly on 11, so my watch is not right. I'm glad I came here today. There we go. All right.
That's about right.
That looks good.
So do they set the church clock by the sundial?
Yes, they do, just like we did our watches.
Huh. Yeah.
Oh no. Is it? Uh-oh.
It might be a little bit broken.
Oh, you know what? It doesn't matter. We're almost at Brother Vogler's house. Let's get him to repair it.
That sounds like a good idea.
Okay.
So why does Brother Vogler have a clock on his portico? I thought Brother Eberhardt was the watchmaker.
You're absolutely right. Actually, Brother Vogler was much more timely about watch repair, so he added that to his list as well as being a silversmith. So that's why he's doing that. As a matter of fact, he was better at advertising too.
It's so hard to believe that people went from using the sun and the moon and the stars to using fine little gears like these.
You know, that reminds me of an astronomer named Benjamin Banneker, who was 22 in 1753, and he had only seen two timepieces in his whole life. He'd seen a sundial and a pocket watch. But with his knowledge of astronomy, he was able to create a wooden striking clock, much like this, only completely made of wood, that worked for 40 years until it was destroyed in a fire. He was known as one of the first people to ever make a clock in the United States.
That's so impressive.
I know. Have you seen that beautiful tall clock that Brother Eberhardt made?
The one with the lovely case?
Oh yes, that is a lovely case. That case was made by Brother Below. Brother Eberhardt made the clockworks and the beautiful artwork on the clockworks. I love them. What do you call a story that one clock tells another?
I don't know.
Secondhand information.
What do you think I should do with my watch since Brother Vogler isn't here?
I think we could leave it here. He'll repair it later.
I'll just put it over here where he can find it.
That's perfect. You know, I just love clocks and how they work. But I'll save that information for another time. Oh my, time flies when you're having fun.
Yes, I think I have to be somewhere.
Wait, I have a question for you. What is something that is present everywhere but occupies no space? We can measure it, but we can't see it, touch it, get rid of it, or put it in a container. Everyone knows what it is and uses it every day, but no one has been able to define it. We can spend it, save it, waste it, or kill it, but we can't destroy it or even change it. And there's never any more or less of it. Do you know what the answer is?
Is the answer time?
Yes, it is. As a matter of fact, it's time to go. Auf Wiedersehen.